the Mole, letting you know that The Wind in the Islands is brought to you by Glass Goat, an art studio and farm in the Thousand Islands. Check them out at glassgoat.com.
Welcome to another chapter of The Wind in the Islands by Scott Oderkirk. Chapter 7, The Swarm.
The Mole woke to a humming sound. At first he thought he was dreaming, but as he became more awake, he realized he wasn't. He listened, but couldn't identify the sound. He glanced out the window and saw nothing. Slipping on his moccasins, he crept out of the bedroom and down the stairs, quietly searching for the source of the humming. Finding nothing in the rat's house, he ventured out to the dooryard. The sound was growing, but still he saw nothing. He noticed a large shadow creeping over his own and looked up to find not a rain cloud, but a cloud of honeybees. Scared, the mole ran back to the entrance to the rat's house where he cowered and watched as the bees changed from a large, loose cloud into a smaller, dense one, and then flowed as one toward the dock. The mole thought to himself, "They're going to take the skiff!" It was a foolish thought, but he had a lot of those. His fears were banished when the bees landed on the oar, which was leaning against the dock railing. They formed a large ball the size of a small watermelon until only a few were in the air. "I must go get the rat," he thought. Not for the first time that summer, the mole gave the rat's shoulder a shake to wake him.
"What is it now?"
the rat said, rubbing his eyes with his fists. "There's a bundle of bees on the oar by the railing," said the mole.
"A bundle of bees?"
said the rat, wondering now if he was dreaming. "Yes, a bundle," said the mole.
"This I must see," answered the rat.
Moving quietly out the front door with the mole pointing excitedly but keeping quiet for once, the rat quickly saw the bundle.
"It's a swarm,"
he said. "A swarm?" asked the mole.
"Yes, it's how the bees make two hives out of one,"
said the rat.
"When they feel too crowded in their hive, they begin by creating a new queen."
"What's wrong with the old one?" interrupted the mole.
"Mole, just listen and let me finish,"
said the rat.
"The new queen is made by feeding several of the baby bees what is called royal jelly. Any baby bee can become a queen this way. They will create several new queens, but only one will survive because a hive can only have one queen. Just before the new queens start to hatch, the old queen and a number of bees will leave the hive as a group in what's called a swarm, which is what we're witnessing right here. When the new queens in the original hive have hatched, they will fight it out until only one is left."
"But what happens to the swarm?" asked the mole.
"Right now, they're sending out scouts from what you called a bundle, searching for a new home. It could be in the wall of a house or in a hollow tree. When a scout finds a suitable home, he comes back and does a dance."
"A dance?" interrupted the mole again, with wide eyes, not quite believing this.
"Which describes to the others where the potential home is and how big it is,"
said the rat.
"More scouts fly out to look for other sites as well as check on the old ones already found. The bees watch each of these dances and then decide as a group which location to move to. Then they fly as a group, with the queen in the center, where she is right now, by the way, to the new home and move in. In very little time, they start drawing out honeycomb using beeswax, and soon there is a whole new hive,"
explained the rat. "Can we follow them and see where they go?" asked the mole.
"It's possible, if one can follow the bee line, except right now, I am going to get the bear,"
said the rat. "I thought bears were the enemies of bees, stole their honey and wrecked their hives," said the mole.
"This bear is an exception. He has a bee farm called Hivernation. He is not your usual bear,"
said the rat.
"I must hurry. Sometimes the bees will stay in their bundle for days, but often only for a short while."
The rat jumped into the water and swam toward the shore, knowing that if he lugged the mole along with him, he would never get back in time. With the mole along, they would have to look at everything at Hivernation, while the mole asked numerous questions. Once on shore, he shook the water from himself and headed off to find the bear. The mole impatiently searched the shoreline with the binoculars while repeatedly turning his head to see if the bees were still there. Several times he scared himself when he forgot and looked at the bees through the binoculars, making it appear that they were right on top of him. Finally, he spotted the rat, followed by a huge black bear with what looked like a basket under one arm and a sack under the other. The bear and the rat reached a low boat at the same time and began rowing it toward the mole and the bees. The rat tied them up when he arrived at the dock while the bear stepped out, making the dock creak, and began preparing his equipment. The rat took the basket part of the way to the bees but stopped short.
That's as close as I'm going without any netting, said the rat.
Netting? Asked the mole. But the rat never answered because just then the bear strolled by with a net over his head, answering the question silently. He picked up the basket and walked right up to the bees. The humming seemed to calm slightly, as if the bear had put them under a spell. In no time at all, he turned the basket, called a skep, the mole later found out, set it down, then gently lifted the oar covered with bees above it, and with one quick motion shook almost all the bees into the basket. The bear placed a board on what was the basket's bottom to keep the bees inside, flipped it back right side up, and tied the board in place with a rope.
"Robert's your mother's brother,"
said the bear with a booming voice that seemed to work its way into the mole's chest.
"He means Bob's your uncle, I think," said the rat to the mole.
"Yup,"
said the bear as he walked right past them with the bees humming inside the basket, got in his boat, and flipped a small glass jar of honey to the mole. Luckily, the mole managed to catch the jar as the bear rode away.
"He's a man of few words,"
said the rat as he walked into the house.
"Let's have breakfast."
The mole held the jar up to the morning sun and marveled at the golden treasure inside. "This will be good on my toast," he said to himself as he followed the rat inside.